Sunday Morning on BBC Radio Scotland.
And welcome. This is Sunday Morning with me, Connie McLaughlin. I hope you're doing well. We've got so much to talk about between now and 11 o'clock, including, right, if maybe right now you're heading to church, how would you feel if your minister's sermon was replaced by one generated by artificial intelligence? More on what that might look like a bit later in the programme. It is 20 years, can you believe, since Movember was set up. I'm going to be finding out how it's helped men to open up about their mental and their physical health later in the programme. There's also, of course, this week been a lot of conversation about addiction since the death of friend star Matthew Perry. I'm going to be chatting to someone later about their own challenges with addiction and how they were able to help other people. It is Sunday morning though, which means lots of great music on the programme, starting with this from Harold. We'll be right back. way to start the morning, wasn't it? Right, we've got lots to talk about between 9 and 10 o'clock, including this, right? Could the hours ministers have to spend writing their Sunday sermons become a thing of the past? A church in Germany recently held a service entirely designed and delivered, by the way, by AI, right? The 40-minute sermon included text-generated OpenAI's ChatGPT chatbot and delivered by avatars on a television screen above the altar, whatever next. And last week, of course, you might have seen this in the news, the two-day summit, the AI safety summit was here in the UK. It was attended by the Prime Minister, Rishi Sunak, and among others, Elon Musk. The big concern from that summit was if AI is going to run out of control, how real a risk, though, is that? Let's speak to Chris Goswami, who is a Baptist minister. He also worked in Silicon Valley for the past 30 years, and he's the creator of the AI Christian Partnership. Good morning to you, Chris.
Good morning, Connie. It's great to be with you.
Yeah, thanks for coming on. Listen, there's an awful lot we can talk about here on this, but I want to just start by asking you a little bit about this summit this week. How useful do you think that was, and what were the sort of main things coming out of it?
Well, perhaps best summarised by, I saw a cartoon in the newspaper yesterday, Connie. It was by Matt, and there were two little boys sitting on a fence. And one little boy said to the other, "When you grow up, what job do you want AI to do for you?" Yeah. I think the summit helped to raise the profile of this in society and helped us to gain a shared understanding of the risks and the opportunities. The fact is, AI will change our world and our church to the same extent that the internet did. There's huge potential for good and for harm. So the summit basically came out with an agreement. I think 25 or 28 countries signed to say that at least reputable AI bots will subject their models, their AI, for national testing. China didn't sign, and there's lots of other things that didn't quite happen. But basically, the idea was we can't leave tech organizations to mark their own homework just to keep this stuff safe and well as it is, to ring fence it in, that the world has to do something. And I guess it achieved some of that. I mean, the risk is it might end up like COP, the climate summit, you know, everybody signs up, but there's not a great deal of action, and you get this kind of traveling circus every year or two.
I thought it was really interesting, actually, that story that was coming out of Germany, because I'd never really thought about this before, about how it sort of could, in some way, infiltrate the world of faith, this sermon that was delivered by AI. Give us a bit of a sense of what that looked like, and I suppose how people felt about it when they saw it and heard it.
Yeah, I mean, it was all in German, and my German isn't great, but as you say, the prayers were written by AI, the worship songs were written by AI, the sermon was written by AI, and it was all delivered by AI, by images of bots speaking. I have to say, generally, the congregation were unimpressed. They said it seemed to lack emotional content. It was a bit wooden. A couple of people said, you know, the bots were speaking so fast, it was hard to understand them. And I think that's fair enough. Somebody did it almost just as a proof of concept that it's possible to do this, and that will improve. You know, that was probably June or July. So even in the last few months, it's the pace of this thing that's catching up with us. I think that using AI instead of humans brings many risks. Using AI as a co-pilot working alongside a human actually can be great. So, Emma, I can give you... Go ahead.
No, I was just going to say, I looked at this because the one that we're talking about is ChatGPT, right, which I think a lot of people are talking about right now. I tried to write a script using ChatGPT, actually, for this programme, and the similarities, I'm going to say, weren't great in terms of the sort of... the way and a script that we would want to use for this programme, because we've got very high editorial values,
of course.
But you're absolutely spot on. It was almost that you could see the structure there. You could see what it was trying to do, but it just wasn't quite there yet. But as you say, because this is moving so quickly, maybe if I did it next week, you never know, we could do the whole programme in it.
Well, not just that, but actually a lot of this comes down to how did you ask the question?
Exactly.
So, so, for example, I some months ago said to one of these bots, I think it was Jasper, I said, write me a sermon for a Christian audience based on encouraging one another based on this verse in the Bible, right? And within 3 seconds, it started saying, beloved brothers and sisters, we're gathered today. And I said, no, stop. Now make it use informal, snappy language. In fact, use my words because I have stuff on the internet. And then it responded, life can be tough and it's not always easy to remain strong, but we're going through. It came up with a sermon that wasn't great, but it was passable. So what we're having to do, what AI will force us to do is rather than solving problems, we're learning to ask questions in the right way. So if you can ask question, if you can ask the question in the right way, put the prompt in the right way, you get a much better answer. And so there's even a new form of engineering called prompt engineering, which isn't a guy who turns it up at your house on time. A prompt engineer is actually somebody who's paid potentially a lot of money to work out how to ask AI to write stuff. So, for example, AI can write software programs, but you need to ask it in the right way. You know, it can write text, it can write scripts, it can write poetry, it can do art, but you have to ask it the right way.
And that's the thing where collaboration comes into this, because I think the German example was a good one, that because probably people knew that it was, you know, they were part of this process and were probably expecting not to have the same connection as they might with their minister. And I suppose in that respect, it comes with the same connection they've got with God and that relationship. The AI can in some way potentially support that rather than replace it.
Yeah, so, you know, rather than write a sermon for you, which I think there's several issues with that, which we can talk about. Last week, I uploaded a sermon I'd already written to AI, a thing called Pulpit AI. So this is the sermon I gave 3 or 4 weeks ago, and I uploaded the audio file. And it took about 5 minutes, but then in 5 minutes, the application gave me back a blog based on my sermon, a week's worth of daily devotions based on the sermon, an email to my congregation summarizing it, sound bites to put on social media, 10 study group questions, all based on my sermon. So that potentially could save me a lot of time. It all needed tweaking and adapting and adjusting. But that's that's as a co-pilot. The Alpha organization who do the Alpha course, which is an evangelistic course run by many churches, there was a hackathon a couple of weeks ago, and a company developed a bot called the BetaBot, and the BetaBot can answer all kinds of questions. So, for example, you know, what do Muslims think about this chapter of Genesis, or what about the problems in the Middle East right now? What does the Bible have to say for that? These are all questions that guests get asked on an Alpha course. But the idea is the Alpha course leader uses the bot in a conversational way to curate what comes back, again, as a co-pilot, not instead of.
Yeah, it sounds definitely something that, you know, we're all looking for balance in our life, right? And many of us might feel as if we work a little bit too much and we spend time in places that we don't want to spend. This could potentially be the answer to solving a lot of those questions. Was that part of it for you in terms of why you started the AI Christian Partnership? Was there something about that you thought, right, well, I can see potentially this could be a force for good, and this is how we can bring it all together?
Yeah, both sides of it. So force for good, but also one of the first people, I wrote an article a few months ago, and one of the first people to come back to me was the CEO of a national charity called Youthscape. And Youthscape trained thousands of leaders across the country. And Chris Curtis got on the phone, he said, you know, things that he's thinking about, you know, young people are increasingly turning to bots instead of adults, because a bot is non-judgmental, anonymous, private, as a companion. And you've got sites like replica.ai, and the slogan on the site is, always here to listen, always on your side, always available, unlike, you know, humans. So there are risks where we're kind of outsourcing human contact to AI. So the AI Christian Partnership, we're at aichristian.org if people want to find out more or register for information. AIChristian.org. We're a group of organizations, including Youthscape, the theological think tank Theos, the Faraday Institute for Science and Religion, E-Class Equipping Christian Leaders for Science and the Industrial Christian Fellowship, and a number of individuals. And we share a common belief that AI will transform our world to the same extent the internet did, but at a much faster pace. But we believe that working together, that we can educate Christians to and produce resources to help Christians and society to engage with AI that promote human flourishing and, you know, is in line with the gospel.
It is exciting and scary all at the same time, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely.
Listen, Chris, good to speak to you. I really appreciate you getting up early and coming to speak to us this morning.
You're very welcome. I really enjoyed it. There's loads more we could have done, but I enjoyed it.
I know. This is an hour's programme all of its own, I think, thinking of it. Yeah. And no doubt not the last time we'll speak. Chris Goswami there, who, of course, is certainly much more of an expert on AI than me. What do you think about this? Is this something that you're thinking this could be something that could help me in the future? An interesting topic, certainly. And if, by the way, you're heading off for your own type of prayer this morning, you can listen to the rest of the programme later on. You can always catch up on BBC Sounds. All you need to do is just search Sunday Morning with me, Connie McLaughlin. Right, lots to come before 10. More music now, though, in the shape of this by
Wake up. Ooh, girl, you know it's been a long time since we linked up and we got wild. Next day, everybody with the same line. Girl, you had the whole place going up like, ooh, such a mood. I've never been so close in the vibe. You know it's been a good night when I say that I looked up.
Drinks and making a will.
Nothing like a little bit of Prince to start you off in the morning. That was Starfish and Coffee. It is just coming up to, or just 23 minutes after 8 o'clock. The Sunday show is after me at 10 o'clock this morning. Martin Geisler and Fiona Stockert will be with you on the radio, on the TV. We're going to be talking about addiction shortly, but we thought we would just let you ease into that with some more music. This.
Best that I can. Why my way gets so hard? You know I just don't understand. Oh Lord, I need you to hold my hand. I can't make travel from place to place. Many times I'm treated so bad. Then I sit and think about I can't miss a friend that I never had. Oh Lord,
oh Lord, I need you to hold my hand.
I can't make it by myself. Surely fall.
Jesus,
I need your strength.
Hold me.
Need your mercy, Lord.
Jesus,
if you hold me,
hold me,
everything will be alright.
Jesus,
somebody need you,
hold me,
to be a doctor, Jesus.
Jesus,
somebody need you,
hold me,
to be a lawyer.
Jesus,
somebody lying,
hold me,
on the bed of affliction.
Jesus,
they have pain. So much pain,
Jesus.
So much pain,
hold me.
Pain in their body,
Jesus.
They're saying, hold me,
hold me,
right now, Lord,
Jesus.
Lord, I need you,
hold me,
right now, Lord,
Jesus.
You are not there,
hold me,
oh, Jesus.
Hold me,
oh, me, Lord,
Jesus.
Here on BBC Radio Scotland, it's Connie McLaughlin with you until 10 this morning. Now, the death of Friends star Matthew Perry has made the headlines last week. Fans, of course, around the world expressing their shock, their sadness. But many people also commented on the actor's troubles over the years with addiction. So we thought we would talk about this morning. How does addiction, be it to drug, alcohol, or whatever else, how does it overtake your life? And how do you overcome this illness, which, of course, has the power to destroy lives? We've seen this many times before. Here to talk more about that with us this morning is Bruce Budge, who's here to tell us about his story. Morning, Bruce.
Good morning.
Thanks so much for coming on. Tell us a little bit about what happened to you.
Well, my addiction was to alcohol. I first discovered alcohol as a 14-year-old boy in Leith Links. Some friends and I had bought a small carrier And immediately I drank it, I felt this warm glow. I felt that I was impervious to anything. It made me feel absolutely fantastic. And what happened was that I kept chasing that feeling, that euphoria, but I never ever refound it.
And what do you think at that moment, that feeling, especially at that age, you know, continuing to chase that, did there become a moment for you that you thought, right, okay, there's something not right here. There's something that I need to, this is now becoming more than just something that I'm enjoying.
Well, that didn't actually occur until I was probably 21 or 22.
Give us a bit of a sense of how much at that point. How much would you have been drinking?
Well, when I reached 21, 22, I was drinking most days. Mm. After work, my days off, I would drink. It was causing me real problems. I was a weekly paid person, and I always made sure that I had payday off work. And I would just come in. I worked out at Gogarburn Hospital, and I just come back into Edinburgh, and, you know, usually with a couple of colleagues, and I'd end up drinking my entire wages one day. And that caused problems at home with my parents. I couldn't give them big money. I was constantly in debt. And I was just really putting a very brave face on everything. Anybody asked me, are you okay? And I said, I'm fine. It's not a problem. I just like a wee drink, you know. And from that point onwards, over the next few years, things were drastically worse. I trained as a nurse and then lost my job as a nurse. And I worked in an alcoholic unit in Royal Edinburgh Hospital. Where we kind of specialised in drying out alcoholics. And then, you know, some treated it as a six-monthly or yearly MOT, get themselves physically fit, and then go back out and have another bash at drinking. I spoke to my GP in 1976, so I'd be, what was that? 24, and I told him about my drinking issues, and he recommended that I be admitted to the self-same unit that I'd worked in, and my pride and my ego would not let me do that, because I was going to have to admit to my colleagues or ex-colleagues that I was an alcoholic. The strange thing is, they already knew. They saw me turning up for work half drunk, not coming in at all, coming in halfway through the shift. And it was just an intolerable situation for them and for me. And within, I got fired in the June, and by Christmas I was homeless. I'd sold everything that I owned. For alcohol, and all I cared about was getting drunk, how to get money for drink. I was a very good con man, con people into giving me money or goods, which I would then sell. And I started getting in trouble with the police as well. So my life, you know, was well and truly down the tubes at that point.
So going from, you know, training and being sort of seeing clearly the path that you wanted to go down within nursing and how it dramatically unfolded from that point, you know, into homelessness, losing your job, and then into prison, as you were mentioning there, but your brushes with the police. What, you know, did that at any point... Were you thinking to yourself, or what were you thinking? What was going through your head when, or was it so gradual that it was almost difficult to claw your way back to the life that you had before?
the only thought I had in my head was getting drunk. That was the most important thing in my life. I wasn't working, so I was just claiming benefits. And when I got my benefits, the gyro check, I cashed it and immediately drank it. And from 76 until about 78, I'd be homeless on the streets, or else I'd be in a cheap B&B. Sometimes I was lucky and I got a bed set, but I would never pay the rent. And so I'd get thrown out, because every penny that came my way was spent on drink. And that was my sole thought. I thought of nothing else.
What happened at that point whenever you went to prison? How did your relationship with alcohol change? Did it change? What was it like when you were there?
Well, I was jailed for a total of 16 years for committing offences to buy alcohol, get money to buy alcohol. Mm-hmm. And when I went into prison, I just put it to the back of my mind. At that time, substances like cannabis and Valium, all sorts of drugs were available in prison. And I used them because being sober from alcohol at that time, I didn't want to think about why I was there, what had brought me there. So I would use these other substances to block that out. Mm. Just as I used alcohol to block out all my worries, because once I had a drink, I forgot about everything else. People I was owed money to, where I was going to sleep that night, didn't matter. It was all about getting alcohol.
Like an anaesthetic in some way to stop the pain of the things that you knew that were there. And do you know one thing that's really clear, Bruce, is that when you're talking is that the power that this has over you, the power that addiction has over people. There was a moment though, a turning point for you. Tell us about what happened there and what changed.
Well, I'll tell you what actually happened. I was in Perth Prison. And we did a collaboration with Upper Springlands, which was, it used to be the Scottish Council for Spastics, but it was a residential unit for people with multiple physical disabilities. And I met one of the residents, and we got on well. He was a man who'd been a professional footballer. He'd been in a car accident. He was the only one that was injured. He suffered brain damage, and as a result, he was hemiplegic. He spoke with a stutter and had no short-term memory. But he inspired me because he sat and passed his higher English. He wrote books and poetry. He even had an affair with a farmer's wife, which I thought is amazing. And I thought to myself, here's my friend with all these problems, but he's got a life. And I thought to myself, maybe if I can do something about my alcohol problem, I too can have a life. But I had no idea how I was going to achieve that.
And the meetings were part of that.
I went to a meeting of a 12-step fellowship, mutual aid group, whatever you like to call it, and I went there not to get sober but to get a cigarette because I had none, and I went to that meeting and I got my cigarettes, I got a cup of tea, some biscuits, and I also got the offer of sobriety. And it was free. In prison, everything has a price. And here we're a group of men and women offering me something for nothing. And that blew my mind, because I'd been searching for something for so long when I was in prison. I tried religion, going to church, going to Bible class, joined a Buddhist ashram, but none of it was for me, because the God that they were offering me was one that wanted to cast me as a perpetual sinner. And what I wanted was forgiveness, and I wanted love, and I wanted care. And the organization that helped me told me that I could have a higher power of my own conception. So I wanted a loving God, a kind God, and a caring God, and that's what I got. And that was the biggest thing that happened to me, you know.
You know, it's funny because that's something I think, if we're all honest, you know, in our life, that's what everyone is looking for, isn't it? That love, that care, just that sort of the simplicity of that, I think just speaks volumes. Bruce, thank you so much for taking the time to speak to us, for being so honest and sharing your story this morning.
Thank you for the opportunity. It's wonderful to be here.
Yeah, that was Bruce Budge there talking about his experiences, being so open, being so candid. And we're going to be continuing the theme, actually, of men's well-being in a couple of minutes' time. Movember is marking its 20th year. Can you believe that? We'll talk about that after some more music. This is Randy Travis with Forever and Ever.
Promise you now, this love that I feel for you always will be. For you're not just time that I'm killing. I'm no longer one of those guys. As sure as I live, this love that I give is gonna be yours until the day that I die. Takes its toll on the body, makes the young girl's brown hair turn gray. But honey, I don't care, I ain't in love with your hair. And if it all fell out, well, I'd love you anyway. They say time can play tricks on memory, make people forget things they knew. It's happening to me. I've already forgotten every woman but you. Oh, darling, I'm gonna love you forever. Forever and ever, amen. As long as old men sit and talk about the weather. As long as old women sit and talk about old men. If you wonder how long I'll be faithful, but just listen to how this song ends. I'm gonna love you forever and ever, forever and ever, amen. I'm gonna love you forever and ever, forever and ever. Amen.
Forever and Ever by Randy Travis.
Yes, come on!
All new this autumn on BBC iPlayer.
Are you even listening?
Hmm?
This is important.
Feel the heat in Boiling Point.
Go out there and smash it.
Catch up with old friends in Ghosts.
Yes!
Well done, Robin. You just wooed 170-year-old woman.
Excuse me.
And make room for Sort Your Life Out.
Shall we see what we're dealing with? A mouse.
Well, how am I expected to paint in these conditions?
Watch on BBC iPlayer.
Is on fire. Join us live. Saturday, November 18th is our next free watch party at Dave & Buster's. Watch AEW Full Gear with us. It's free to watch at Dave & Buster's in Memphis. Sunday, November 19th, former Impact Wrestling World Champions Josh Alexander and Eric Young are coming to Memphis Wrestling. Sunday, December 10th is our annual Grind City Rumble featuring Warhorse. Reserve your seat today. All tickets are on sale now. Get yours right now at memphiswrestling.tv.
How you doing? You're listening to Sunday Morning with me, Connie McLaughlin. It is November, right? That time of year when you see some of your male friends, family, maybe colleagues grow, or in some cases attempt to grow a moustache. And this year, the movement is marking its 20th anniversary since its inception in an Australian bar. It's raised funds and started viral conversations about men's health issues such as testicular cancer, prostate cancer, and mental health and suicide prevention. So, how important the work campaigns like this and helping men just to talk openly about their health and their well-being, especially their emotional well-being. That is a key factor, isn't it? Here to talk to me this morning is Reverend Philip Blackledge, Rector of Holy Trinity Melrose, and Ross Hislop, counsellor and coach. Morning, both of you.
Good morning.
Good morning. Morning.
Philip, how important do you think campaigns like Movember still are? How helpful are they just to push these conversations forward?
I think they're hugely important, and Movember's done a huge amount of good for male mental health. And it's not to deny that mental health isn't an issue for everybody. But in my experience of being a priest, I mean, I've been ordained 20 years, which is about the length of time Movember's been going on. And men are much harder to reach in terms of being able to admit that they have a problem and in terms of the approaches that you can use to dealing with them. So the more public acknowledgement that we all suffer mental health issues, and we all do, the more publicity that there is, and the more the sort of celebrities and people in positions of authority can sort of say they too have mental health issues, the better it is. It's improved vastly in the last 20 years, but there is an enormous amount more to do. So the more the better.
Ross, do you think campaigns like this, and especially something that's very targeted towards guys, is important, given everything that Philip's saying there, that we know and the statistics tell us that men are harder to reach in this area than women?
Absolutely. It's never really been encouraged for men to speak up. The ideology around about it, that big boys don't cry and just brush off any sensitivity they might be feeling or emotional discomfort around about any situation they're presented with. So Movember has opened up an awareness around about, you know, what was the slogan, I think, grow a mo to save a bro, using their face as a advertisement to open up these conversations that people might not be aware of.
Philip, do you think that, you know, talking about your time in the sort of pastoral sense, right, do you, and without obviously going into any detail, do you get the sense that when men do come to you, it's about different things than women come to you about? Is there other things going on in men's heads, you guys will know that better than me, that we're not really quite addressing properly? Are the worries and cares different?
Possibly. I mean, there are things that affect us all, you know, grief or the loss of a divorce, family breakup, that sort of thing. I think there's a particular issue in terms of sort of how men see themselves in the world these days. The number one cause of death for young men under 25 is suicide, and it has been for years. And if it was any other disease, we'd call it an epidemic. But because it's suicide, somehow we think it's, you know, it's different. And some of that is that there are so many competing models of how to be a man. You know, on the one hand, you've got the sort of Andrew Tate sort of model of sort of quite dominating, sort of powerful figure that there's a bit of society which is saying that men should be like. And on the other hand, you've got a sort of very different understanding of what it is to be a man, which is, you know, far more integrated into sort of a male-female society. And I think that model has changed since the 50s so much that men don't necessarily have role models in the generations above that can understand where they are now. And that creates a lot of problem. And of course, with men, one of the symptoms of mental ill health can be aggression. Mm. You know, that's a symptom, mm-hmm. because mm-hmm. aggression is what happens when we don't know what emotions to feel. But of course, if people see aggression, they don't see a symptom of mental ill health. They see something that they need to defend themselves against. So it becomes much more difficult to sort of get hold of and embrace.
Is it confusing, Ross, for men to sort of know who they should be? Because, you know, as Philip was saying there, this idea of what it is to be a man is changing so much.
Yes, I agree very much with what Philip was saying there around about role models and what it means to be a man. When we start to draw the line, we're not that much different, men yeah. and women. It's just women have different, perhaps, mechanisms that they might move towards men, as Philip said, would use aggression and perhaps substance or alcohol misuse, whereas it's much more prevalent that women would perhaps come up against eating disorders as a coping mechanism against their emotional ill health, if you like.
And certainly you've been doing your bit. You've been trying to help and do work across sort of all ages with men. You're doing things like hill walking and getting people out and physically active. What are you hearing from the men that you're speaking to and that you know you go out with and chat to?
Across the board, the main theme is loss of connection, where they don't have a place where they just get together anymore. You know, in the olden days, I guess, in the 50s, they would have stood in the corner. I was speaking to somebody recently. My grandfather used to congregate at the top of the road on the summer seat and talk about simple things such as the amount of traffic going up and down the roads. Society's made things so busy that people are stressed and not managing their stress effectively. And it's only when we can get out and get into groups and start to speak about how we're feeling that's one of the ways that we can start to address the stress that's going on underneath the surface.
What does that do to us on a spiritual level, Philip, when we're not open, when we're not able to connect in that way?
It can be really hard, not least because a lot of the mechanisms that we have for dealing with mental ill health, you know, sort of talking therapies, you know, counselling and psychotherapy and things, that's not necessarily where a lot of men are. You know, those therapies were formed by very verbal, intellectual people. And if you're a verbal, intellectual person, they can really help. But sometimes, as Ross was saying, I mean, you know, there's lots that used to be wrong with the pub culture, but actually, it was really good therapy. I remember when my own mum was really ill, and thankfully she survived. But, you know, Dad was in a real state, and we went to the pub, and his mates were there for him, and we could talk about the issues in a bit. You know, we could have 2 minutes talking about mum, and somebody would say a silly joke, and we'd talk about politics. And it was ideal therapy for him because, above everything, you know, we're herd beasts. We need to be in our pack. And if you don't have a pack, you feel isolated and alone. And all of those thoughts that you would normally find an outlet for, whether it's, you know, just being quiet in a pub or being quiet in a church, you know, you don't, they whirl around your head and they get worse. And that's really corrosive for us.
Just that, even the description of what was going on for your dad there, the sort of sense I was getting from what you were saying is he just really felt held in that space. And that, you cannot put a price on the importance of that, Philip.
Yeah, absolutely. Sometimes there's very little that you can do for your mates, but the little that you can do can be absolutely transformative. And in a lot of the pastoral care that I do with men, you know, as Ross said, you go for a walk. You're not facing each other and having to sort of face the issue. Mm. You can do it in your own time and in your own space and in your own rhythm. You know, I've often taken guys to the driving range for the same reason. So you're not facing each other and there's something to do. You know, men feel that they're valued when they feel that they're useful. So getting guys to, you know, I've got guys to rake the churchyard leaves with me, you know, and that's mm-hmm. that's a
just
way
being
that we
together, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. And it doesn't sound like a lot, but it can be everything.
Do you know, Ross, it's funny because that idea, just what the Philip's saying there about the togetherness, and also going back to that idea of some people find it difficult to articulate how they're feeling. And we often hear this phrase of it's good to talk, you know, just open up to someone. But whenever people find that hard, what do they do? What do they, you know, what can happen to, or how can we access people who don't really have the words to be able to express how they're feeling at this point, but they're feeling, you know, that they need help?
Absolutely. I think that's one of the major challenges that's faced, that we're telling people to talk about how they feel, but underneath that, we need to first know what it is that we're feeling. And so many men have been conditioned and pushed it so far down that they're not in touch with their emotional body at all. So being in company of others that have that capacity, just by encouraging it, like, you know, very, very simply put, you seem upset by that. You have I said something to annoy you? Well, I'm not annoyed. Well, you seem to be. And mirroring back their state and also openly communicating about how we're feeling encourages other people to do the same.
It's tricky, isn't it? Because there's this idea of, now you see all these different trends on TikTok. Everyone wants to mm-hmm. try and be a counsellor or a therapist with a different sort of ways that they're trying to access your people and speak to people. And there's these sort of the trending words now that are used probably often in the wrong sense. But I worry, or I wonder rather, how we need to be careful when we're having conversations like this, that it's important to have them, but how do we have them in a way that's kind and is a way that's really going to be able to actually get people to open up and talk?
It can be quite hard to approach people in a way like that, and in a way that the sort of the things that Ross and I sort of described, the sort of the gentle nudges into a space where people feel safe, really, really matters. And there's a lot of community things that we used to do that post-pandemic we don't do anymore. I mean, music has been a massive part of my life, and, you know, music reaches you when you don't have the words. That's sort of what music does. You know, when you don't have words to describe feelings, music provides that for you. And, you know, singing together, making music, and whether that's, you know, chanting in a football pitch, you know, with your team, or whether it's in a disco, whether it's in a church choir, that all makes a big, big difference to how you are, because it does give you that sort of sense of not being alone. Some, you know, direct head-on buzzword cancelling things do work for people, and, you know, I would argue that you know, as long as you're in a crowd of people who love you and support you, it's never wrong to be in that crowd. But as long as we're aware that that's only going to reach a certain number, we've mm-hmm. got to look for other ways as well.
Well, funny you should mention the music. You're going to be staying with us, Philip, to talk a little bit more about that later in the programme. So stick around for that. Ross, thank you so much for joining us this morning.
Thank you. Enjoy the rest of your day.
Thank you. That's Ross Hislop there and Philip Blackledge. Still to come, before 10 o'clock. I'm going to be finding out how interfaith relations in Scotland are being impacted by the Israel-Gaza war. And also, Scientologists have gathered in the UK over the past few days at the former home of the late founder L. Ron Hubbard. I'm going to be finding out more about the origins and central beliefs of Scientology. And as we were just saying there, sacred music. What is it about music that can touch our soul? The 9 o'clock news is coming up. Taking us there, though.
Yeah.
with a major gathering of Scientologists in the UK last week. I'll be finding out more about the organisation and its sometimes controversial practices and the power of sacred music to inspire and lift us up. I think we could all be doing with a bit of that this morning. I'll be in the company of two people passionate about composing and listening to it all before 10. Lots of great music, though, of all kinds on the show this morning. This is Natalie Merchant with...
My lovely, where do you go? I wanna know, my lovely.
Thank you.
Now, the ongoing conflict in Israel and Gaza has had a deep impact on the international diaspora, hasn't it? While the conflict is taking place many miles from Scotland, the effects are being felt here among various faith communities. But how do we keep community cohesion when there seems to be so much anger, so much fear and division? And I guess what role do interfaith organisations play in helping those communities talk to each other? That's what we're going to talk about for the next little while. Professor Joe Goldblatt, Chair of the Edinburgh Interfaith Association, is with us. He's also Jewish. Good morning, Professor Joe.
Good morning, Carl.
We also have with us Iman Hassan Rabbani, who is a Muslim chaplain at Heriot Watt University in Edinburgh. Good morning to you, Iman.
Hi, good morning.
As I say, there's so much to talk about here, Hassan, but the conflict, as we know, is having a deep impact on many people in Scotland, particularly in faith communities. How would you describe the situation as you see it right now?
Like many people, very saddened about what has happened at the 7th, from 7th October, in fact, when we saw the early attacks taking place. And then after that, what's been unfolded ever since then, the loss of innocent life, civilian life, or perhaps on both sides, but in particularly the humanitarian catastrophe that's happened in Gaza, has left many people frustrated, especially in the faith communities. But I think it's quite important how we channel that frustration. And for a faith leader like me and many of my colleagues, the idea is we don't want this to overspill in Scotland. So we have to be quite positive how we channel those kind of energies through protests, through prayer, through charity, making sure that still we have this cohesive society and community in Scotland.
That's the challenge, isn't it, Joe, ensuring that that cohesion is still there. What are you seeing and how would you describe the situation in Scotland and the Jewish community?
Well, thank you, Connie. And let me just begin by saying what an honour and a privilege it is to appear with my brother in peace, Sheikh Hassan Rabbani, who's one of the most respected and esteemed imams in our country. What I see is a tale of two cities, Mr. Dickens said so many years ago, it is indeed the best of times and the worst of times. The worst of times, as Hassan just mentioned, is the sadness of the death and destruction taking place in the Middle East. But the best of times are people coming together for peace. One example of this is on the 13th of November at St. Mary's Episcopal Cathedral in Edinburgh. Hundreds of people will come together, sponsored by the Edinburgh Interfaith Association, to meditate, to reflect, and to pray for peace. We need more of these positive occasions in all of our cities in Scotland.
That coming together, Hassan, is something really special. And I guess when it's people from lots of different backgrounds coming together, how important is that, that's visible to others as well? This sight is so very powerful, seeing people coming and being together.
I think it is very, I mean, images are generally very, very powerful. And I think the solidarity and coming together sends a strong message. I was part of writing a statement up with Jewish faith leaders, along with the Scottish government, about xenophobia, hatred, anti-Semitism, Islamophobia that we're seeing an increase of after this conflict. And it really went down well with the general public. It was the idea of imams and kind of rabbis coming together, just sharing their vulnerabilities and their actual experiences. And even some of the solidarity and protest groups that we have seen have largely been peaceful. But we've seen a lot of Jewish people, a lot of people from different faith coming together, just saying that it's not about faith. You know, as a human, I am greatly moved, actually, by the current situation. And I have come here to support your community, so on and so forth. So although on the outset, it looks like perhaps the relationships between different faiths may be fracturing, but actually there's this increased solidarity that we're actually seeing and a cohesiveness where communities are actually coming together to support each other. And this is actually based on long-term relationships. So I know Joe for a long time, and I know many other faith leaders, and I've been receiving a lot of emails from them you know, just we're thinking of you and your prayers. So a lot of this got to do with the long-term relationships that we've been building here in Scotland for the last decade.
You know, in the programme earlier, we were talking about the openness and the importance of open conversations. Joe, how do you have open dialogue on a subject like this when so many people are in pain, when so many people are hurting, and do that in a way that's able to hold people safely?
I think you start from a place of love, compassion, empathy, listening, because whether you are Muslim or Jew, you are suffering today. We are all suffering. As Hassan has just mentioned, in my own case as a Jewish person, I've been so gratified by the hundreds of emails, text, telephone calls, and even, Connie, random door knocks on my flat, people simply asking, are you okay? Can I do anything to help you? It's really been wonderful. Scotland is a wonderful country with regards to looking after one another.
Yeah, I mean, I would perhaps share the same sentiment here. The people of Scotland are wonderful, and we've seen so many people reaching out to us, to the mosques, to the churches. And I've been reaching out myself out to different faith communities, saying that I'm okay and is there anything that we can do? I think in terms of war and conflict, we see the really human side of us. That, you know, we're suffering together, there's pain there, we need healing, and healing is only done actually through dialogue and conversation.
The difficulty comes, I guess, as well, Joe, that whenever this conflict, or as this conflict continues, we're not only seeing division between communities, but within communities as well. So is that something that you've got a sense of at the moment? And if it is, I guess that's, you know, the work that we're talking about and the continuity and connectiveness that we need, I guess, has to be through all parts of the faith that we have.
Yes, indeed. The playwright Arthur Miller, who wrote Death of a Salesman, wrote during the difficult time in the 1950s when the House Un-American Activities Committee in America was doing a witch hunt for communists throughout the United States and the country was deeply divided. He wrote that during conflict, there's no such thing as bad or good acts by people. Rather, what is revealed is their true character. Well, I believe, and I've seen this within our Jewish community as well as out with, now is the time for all of us to come together in peace.
Well, whenever you know that the goal that you want to get to, Hassan, is what Joe is talking about there is this idea of peace, resolution to this. Mm. But can you give us a bit of a sense of what the challenges are for people here in Scotland who are connected, who are caught up in this conflict? Because those who are not in any way involved per se can see and feel the pain that we see the images. We spoke about that earlier on TV or hearing about it on radio. But what's it like? And if you can explain to us a little bit about people who are living this firsthand through family, through friends, through just their connection to their faith.
I mean, a real example is a dear colleague of mine in Harriet Watt, who is from Gaza, and whose family are there. I've been in touch with him regularly, but he saw his house being destroyed live on Al Jazeera. His family of around 50, 60 have moved to a school. And each time I just see his face, he's, you know, it's very saddened, almost crying. He says, I haven't spoken to them in days. So deep sadness, a lot of fear around that. But I think faith plays an important role here. And this is what we continuously talk about, this idea of patience. God is testing them, but there's a great reward for them. Because I just don't understand how without faith you can come to terms with what's actually happened. Honestly, I think you probably lose your mind. And I think faith has a very important role here. So I'm continuing to support him. But I mean, largely the First Minister had his own wife's family stuck there. And we often saw that from his kind of face and his reaction, how difficult it was just to process that. And now I know they've kind of left Gaza. Mm. I think the general Scottish public couldn't understand that because the First Minister himself, but many of us have colleagues from Gaza and from Palestine and, you know, first-hand stories of actually what's happened. But as a faith leader, for me, it's always going back to faith and how can faith help process all of this.
And I agree, Connie. You know, we all have personal experiences in the Jewish community with Israel, family, friends, etc. One experience I had was searching for the man who supervised my doctoral dissertation, who's now in his 80s. And when I found his daughter online, I also found that her entire family was part of the 200 people who were kidnapped by Hamas. Mm. And I think one of the important things we have to remember is that the Jews do not control the Israeli government. The Muslims do not control Hamas. These are separate political issues. But as the Imam has said, we must have faith. Emily Dickinson, the wonderful American poet, wrote, "Hope is the thing with feathers that perches in the soul and sings the tune without the words and never stops at all." And when I met with the Jewish and Israeli students at Edinburgh University 3 days after the war, and they asked me, "How do you keep your faith, Professor?" I said, 5,000 years ago, the Jews were slaves in Egypt. 3,000 years ago, people tried to kill us. And we're still here.
Faith is central to all of this, isn't it, Hassan? This idea of keeping a sense of, you know, Joe used the word hope there. Mm-hmm. It would be easy for people to feel as if they were losing that hope and losing that faith right now with what we see and what we hear. And the horror doesn't even do it justice in terms of describing that. What would you say to people who feel out there, whatever their faith is, that they might be thinking, I don't understand the reason, I can't contemplate why this would be happening and so much pain and so much hurt on people who are innocent?
I mean, I would suggest just to look at some of the pictures that came out of Gaza where a father lost his 4 kids in an Israeli airstrike. And when he was going over the rubble, he was just saying, they've returned to God, they've returned to God. Stories about mothers who have lost their children again, and they're just incredible patience. And even me as a faith leader, I'm on this other side. And I think, how can people show that remarkable patience? So I think we can also learn people from those who are victims in conflicts, is that how do they process that? And that kind of really helps us from afar, that who feel we can't really do anything. But just looking at them and looking at their resilience really shows a high level of faith that they have. I mean, my friend himself, he's quite sad, but not sad perhaps. Sad that why am I enjoying all this luxury while my family don't have the very basic necessities that are not accessible to them in Gaza? So it's that kind of feeling that has come out. And for the large people, I think that's important just to look at that and say, wow, you know, I mean, this is all faith actually in action, and we can learn from this.
Yeah, I think you're spot on there. That idea of people who are watching on the guilt that you feel for being safe and well. To end things this morning, I know that both of you want to read a poem, which I think sums this up beautifully. Joe, take it away.
Thank you. This is the Iona Community Universal Prayer for Peace. Lead us from death to life, from falsehood to truth.
Lead us from despair to hope, from fear to trust.
Lead us from hate to love, from war to peace.
Let peace fill our lives, our world, our universe.
Peace. Peace.
Thank you so much to both of you this morning. That was beautiful and a lovely way to end this conversation, Hassan Rabbani and Joe Goldblatt. It is BBC Radio Scotland. It is 9:23 and you're listening to Sunday Morning with me, Connie McLaughlin. In a few minutes' time, with a gathering in the UK over the weekend of leading Scientologists, I'm going to be diving into the central beliefs of that and how they were founded. And if you've missed any of the programmes so far, we've been on air since just after eight, you can catch up on BBC Sounds later, including my interview with Bruce Budge. He was talking about overcoming and managing addiction. Some more music for you now. This is John Grant with I Want to Go to Mars.
Bittersweet strawberry marshmallow butterscotch, polar bear cashew, Dixieland phosphate chocolate, lime tutti frutti special raspberry, leave it to me. Three gray scotch lassie cherry smash lemon free. I wanna go to Mars, where rivers flow, and your sweet 16 is waiting for you after the show. I wanna go to Mars, you'll meet the Gold Dust Twins tonight, you'll get your heart's desire, I will meet you under the grapefruit lucky Monday, high school football, hot fudge buffalo, tulip sundae, almond caramel frappe, pineapple root beer, black and white Big Apple, Henry Ford sweetheart, maple tea. I wanna go to Mars, where green rivers flow, and your sweet 16 is waiting for you after the show.
Go to Mars by John Grant here on BBC Radio Scotland. Now, this weekend has seen demonstrators assemble outside Scientology UK's HQ in West Sussex, the venue for what's been billed as the religion's greatest gathering, right? Organisers of the peaceful protests and ex-members of Scientology say the purpose of their demonstration has to be there is to send Scientology a clear message. The abuse must stop. It's been the largest anti-Scientology protest in the UK for 15 years. The church, you might have known, has faced much criticism over the years with allegations of human trafficking, exploitation and claims of separating members from their families. However, the International Association of Scientologists states in their words that the gathering is a reuniting for total freedom to hear about recent victories and to celebrate the heroic things that we do for humanity every day. The church had told the Guardian newspaper the UK protest was harassment and that allegations against the group were totally false. With us to give us a bit of an overview of the church and its critiques is a sociologist of religion and author of Free Zone Scientology, Contesting the Boundaries of a New Religion, Dr. Alad Thomas. Good morning to you, Alad.
Good morning, Connie. How are you?
I'm good, thanks. This is really interesting, right? Because there's a lot of mystery shrouded around Scientology. Let's start from the very beginning, right? What is it and sort of what are the main areas of focus for this faith?
Sure. Well, Scientology is a religion that was founded in the early 1950s by a man called L. Ron Hubbard, who had already reached some fame at the time as a pulp fiction author, particularly in science fiction. And in 1950, he published a book called Dianetics, The Modern Science of Mental Health. That was essentially a self-help therapy book. And it became very popular. And from this, Ron Hubbard eventually developed what's known as the religion angle to Scientology. Bringing it more up to date to the 21st century, while this was American in its origin, Scientology now has a global outreach. And of course, it's particularly well known for its celebrity adherence with people like Tom Cruise and John Travolta, who aren't just Scientologists, but claim that the successes they've experienced as celebrities and in the film industry are as a result of their engagement with Scientology.
But what do people who are Scientologists believe? What's the sort of basis of it?
Right. Well, at the core of Scientology is a practice called auditing, which is essentially a form of religious counselling. Auditing is a series of question and answer exercises which takes an individual through experiences in their past lives and aims to remove what's known in Scientology terms as engrams. This is a term for the anxieties that exists in one's mind.
Mm.
This was, you may be listening to this thinking, well, where's the religious side to this?
It sounds very much like a form of therapy, doesn't it?
Yes, absolutely. And that was the origin of auditing. But as L. Ron Hubbard was developing his practices, the people that he was auditing, the people he was conducting these sessions with, were attesting to experiences of past lives. And it led him to the conclusion that, what I'm doing here isn't simply treating the human mind, but it's also treating the spirit and treating the soul of the individual, known in Scientology as the Thetan.
And is there sort of one idea, or is it all about the self, or is there an external sort of, you know, God that's part of this, or is there a prayer to it? What does that look like and feel like?
Right. Well, if there was a Scientologist in the room with us right now, they would likely tell us that a core aspect of Scientology is what's true for you. So you may meet Scientologists who don't necessarily believe in a God, while there may also be Jewish Scientologists or Christian Scientologists. Primarily, it does concern the notion of the self and the fact that our Thetans, we are a Thetan according to Scientology, is trapped in the physical universe, which causes an individual difficulty, whether that's in terms of spiritual liberation or the way they navigate their lives. Scientology claims to offer its adherents the potential to improve their work-life balance, for example, their relationships with their partners. And this is done through addressing the treatment of the spirit.
And when you're that treatment of the spirit that you're talking about, is that done through prayer? I know there's like services, church services. What does that treatment in inverted commas look like and what do they do?
So the treatment comes back to the auditing process that I mentioned to earlier. Mm. And you may have seen this if you've watched some Scientology documentaries that, of course, it runs in a question and answer style exercise. But a trained auditor will ask a Scientologist to recall experiences from their lives while they hold a device known as an e-meter. And this is a religious device for Scientologists that measures the responses of the individual, particularly their theta, to the answers that they give. And it's through these question and answer exercises, it's through these recallings of past trauma, past experiences, that allows the individual to come to terms with them and to essentially remove them from the mind. Scientologists hope to aim a state known as clear. And when one is clear, they have removed these engrams that I refer to from their minds.
Okay, so that's the sort of the aim part of that is to get to that point of being clear. I mentioned in the introduction, there's been demonstrations this week around the UK headquarters. What are people protesting about?
Right. Yes. So there's a collection of protesters who are gathering across all 3 days of the International Association of Scientologists event, and they are protesting what they claim to be accusations of abuse and coercion within the Church of Scientology. Often these come to controversial aspects of Scientology, particularly the disconnection policy, in which Scientologists are alleged to cease communication with friends and family members who are critical of the church, and to the fair game practice as well. Fair game is perceived to be a practice in which Scientologists adopt heavy-handed methods to counter their critics. I should note here for clarity that the fair game policy was scrapped by the Church of Scientology in 1968. But former members of the church and anti-Scientologists point to examples that they say demonstrates that while fair games has been scrapped, perhaps in name, in practice, it is still happening.
I was just going to ask you how valid you think these criticisms are. Or do you think at times people, because of the sort of documentaries that we've seen that maybe were quite popular, you know, 10, 15 years ago, when some of the bigger celebrities, if you like, were open about their connection with Scientology, are they then unfairly criticised for this idea of, I remember in one documentary, this sort of idea or notion, there was connections with aliens as well. Where does that come in?
Right, yes. Okay. There's a fair amount to unpack there.
I know. That was one question mark, sort of 15 questions marked into one there, wasn't it?
Yes, yes. Well, the first thing I would say there is that when accusations of abuse are made, they do have to be taken very seriously. And I also believe that a survivor's voice has a right to be heard. But I'd say that when we're addressing criticisms towards a religion, that's a very broad thing for us to be doing. I think sometimes we need to distinguish the categories that we're criticizing. So distinguish between the institutional forms of a religion, for example, in contrast to the everyday grassroots adherent who will often have little to nothing to do with the institutional side of their religion. You mentioned there about the beliefs of Scientology. Scientology gets a lot of press due to the upper levels of Scientology when a Scientologist progresses what's known as the bridge to total freedom. And the conversation surrounding aliens or whether Scientologists believe in aliens tends to be brought up when discussing operating Thetan level 3. This is a advanced stage of Scientological study. And for the most part, however, it is important to note that a lot of Scientologists haven't reached this stage themselves. And from the ex-members who have reached that stage and have told us about it, they tend to say that the belief in aliens doesn't play a major part in Scientology. But when people raise questions about aliens and strange beliefs in groups like Scientology, I think, yes, we may say that some of these beliefs seem unusual or strange to us, but it's also worth remembering that it's a perfectly common belief in Britain, for example, that Jesus rose from the dead, turned water into wine, and so forth. These are beliefs that could seem strange to people who are unfamiliar with them. So I think often what we in Britain consider to be a respectable belief or a strange belief simply comes down to our familiarity with it.
Yeah, it stood the test of time, whereas, you know, this seems to be more of a new concept. Dr. Ali, thank you for that. Really interesting. Again, so much to unpack in such a short time, but I think you did it very succinctly. Thank you so much for your time this morning.
Thanks for having me. Take care.
You're very welcome, Dr. Alad Thomas. They're talking about Scientology and trying to just go into that in a little bit more detail. You are listening to Sunday Morning with me, Connie McLaughlin. Before 10, I'm going to be talking about the power of sacred music to move us, right? Different kind of music now, though.
Us with grace, mercy, and peace. And may we always find more room around God's feet, where there is complete rest from the cares of this world. For every woman, man, boy, and girl, I pray we are blessed with God's grace, mercy, and peace, peace, peace. May our God bless us with grace, mercy, and peace. I pray we receive that tonight and always. Find more room around God's feet, where there is complete rest from the cares. Tonight, every woman, man, boy, and girl, I pray we are blessed with God's grace, mercy, and peace. No matter the highs and the lows, the seasons of life may bring, I pray the Spirit of God is revealed and leads us to great and marvelous things. Whether we stay standing side by side, or circumstance determines our goodbyes, I pray we are blessed with God's grace, mercy, and peace. Receive it, and I believe I can see it on you too. I receive it, I receive it, and I believe I can see it on you too. I receive it, I receive it, and I believe I can see it on you too. Grace, mercy, and peace. World for every woman, man, boy, and girl. I pray we are blessed with God's grace, mercy, and
in the Ultra Sheen, Afro Sheen, and 7-Up Dance Contest. Winners get a trip to Hollywood to dance on Soul Train. Grand prize winners each receive a 1975 Chevrolet Monza and a $2,000 scholarship or the cash equivalent. There's lots of other prizes too, nothing to buy, so listen for details on your local radio station and look for the dance contest display at participating dealers. Do it today.
You are listening to BBC Radio Scotland. It's Connie McLaughlin with you until 10 this morning. We've got about just over 15 minutes left of the programme. And if you missed any of it, where have you been, first and foremost? But you can always go back and listen on BBC Sounds. Just search Sunday Morning with Connie McLaughlin and you can catch up on lots that we were speaking about earlier. We're speaking about addiction with Bruce Budge, just hearing his story, and also how AI, artificial intelligence, might be coming potentially to a church near you soon. Who knows? Right, we've got a really lovely conversation about the power of sacred music coming after this by Belle and Sebastian. This is I'm a Cuckoo.
Thank you.
Now, speaking of music, right, the choir of Old St. Paul's Episcopal Church in Edinburgh has just recently released a new CD of sacred music, including several pieces which are world premieres, no less. We're going to be hearing a little extract shortly, but it got us thinking about what is it about sacred music that moves us so much? Is there something unique in traditional choral music and plain song which makes it so evocative for us? And when we hear it, there's just that sort of feeling that we get. And particularly in an increasingly secular society, does sacred music still have a relevance to those without a personal faith? Still with me, Reverend Philip Blackledge, Rector and Choirmaster at Holy Trinity in Melrose. Welcome back, Philip.
Hello.
And we've also got Callum Robertson, the Assistant Director of Music at Old St. Paul's Episcopal Church. Morning, Callum.
Good morning.
Now, you've been with St. Paul's Choir 17 years now?
Yes.
Is that right?
Years. Can't believe that.
Since you came out the womb, obviously.
Just about.
Right. What was it that drew you to the choir in the first place? And I guess that music, did it have even initially that emotional pull for you?
Well, I'd been singing in choir from the age of about five at school, and I'd been playing the piano and learning the clarinet and things. So music was in my life a lot and in the family. But no, I started playing the organ in Drylaw Parish Church in the suburbs of Edinburgh when I was about 13, 14. And I met the director of music at Old St. Paul's, John Kitchen, and he told me about Old St. Paul's. So one evening, I went along to Evensong, and like many people in Old St. Paul's, I came into the church down Carruthers Close off the Royal Mile and entered into this building that I didn't expect to be there. Mm. It really just totally overwhelmed me. Incredible Victorian architecture, very dark church, and then the choir comes in and beautiful plain song, beautiful choral music, wonderful organ playing. It just happened, and the incense was going, and all this ritual was happening, and I was totally hooked on it straight away.
Do you think you need, and I'm going to ask both of you this actually, right? Do you think you need all the other things around it to have the real impact? The fact that you've described that beautifully there, Callum, the senses awakening in all sorts of different ways, and then that's just sort of, you know, the sound that's created just does something particularly, I don't know, different or special than other music. Callum, you first, then I'll get Philip's take on it.
I mean, we're told about, we've got all these senses that, you know, can be focused on, and when you pinpoint all of them at once, that can be a very special moment. But, you know, listening to music just with headphones at home, that can be very powerful as well. But, you know, you can have all sorts happening. But I think you can be in the right place at the right time and be really hit by something powerful and emotional and spiritual.
Philip?
Yeah, you don't need the sort of incense and the church accoutrements, I guess. But what it does is it provides a spaciousness to let the music sit. You know, it gives it a sort of carpet of silence that the music sort of explores in. And Old St. Paul's, have you ever been there? I remember singing there when I was a teenager, at an early morning service for Easter with Richard Holloway as the bishop. And he was spraying us with holy water, and I was doing a solo at 6 o'clock in the morning. And he was a dead shot with this thing, and
I bet
got
that
me in the mouth about four different times. So it wasn't particularly holy. But what the liturgy, what the ritual of worship does is just ease you into a space where you can be receptive to what music does. And I personally think all music is sacred. I think music touches us all in a way which is holy, which is, you know, blessed. And really, the liturgy is just there to sort of to house that in a helpful space.
Right, we've got loads to talk about. I want to hear this. Let's take a little listen. Callum, that was recorded at St. Paul's, and that was the track that you actually wrote, I believe.
Yes, it is, yeah. That's funny enough, that's called Liturgy, a poem by a Catholic, American Catholic sister, Irene Zimmerman. And I came up with that piece back again. Richard Holloway's name's going to be mentioned. In 2018, he preached at the Feast of Mary, Mother of God, in August in one of the festival masses that we do. And I was really hit by, typically by Richard, by his power of preaching. And I investigated into a poem that he read out, and I came across this one. And I just couldn't get it out of my head. It was just so powerful. And during lockdown, that wonderful time, I'm not a composer, but I just thought I'll have a go at writing a piece of music. And this one really lent itself to it. It's four stages of Christ's life and kind of Mary's viewpoint, as it were. The bit that you just heard was when she's pregnant with Christ. The next bit goes on to when he goes into the wilderness, and then the third time is when she holds him after he's been crucified, and then when she runs to meet him. And every time it finishes with, "This is my body, my blood." And hopefully, yeah, I found writing that piece, it kind of cured the earworm of that poem a wee bit.
Which is funny, isn't it? Because there's something that we can get out of listening to it. You clearly, from what you're saying, have got that out of putting it together and creating it. That process of the creativeness is something, I guess, that not everyone will have the gift to do. But, you know, it's funny, whenever we talk about this type of music, and I suppose that what we're trying to say within these pieces of music, it can be different, but also the same as you might find in secular music. Do you feel that you can be moved in the same way, Callum? I'm also going to ask you this, Philip, as well. I know you mentioned a little bit about secular music earlier.
No, of course. I mean, I've gone to many concerts at the Usher Hall and all over the place, and where it's not been religious music, but it's really struck me. I mean, a classic piece of music is the Rite of Spring, Stravinsky's piece, and it's amazing. The last time I heard that in the Usher Hall, the animation of people speaking about it after when leaving the hall, you it still kind of really speaks to people, and it's not a religious piece of music really. It doesn't need to be religious music that can really kind of speak to your soul, I suppose.
Yeah, so. It can be so evocative, Philip, because I think I read somewhere before that music is the only thing that stimulates every part of the brain.
Possibly, it certainly does what it needs to do for me most of the time. And, you know, it can be, you know, you listen to Bach's sacred music and his secular music, and it's pretty much exactly the same. He's doing exactly the same thing. Mm-hmm. And I think, I mean, most of our music that we have is based on sacred music. So I was listening to that Bell and Sebastian piece, and you have in that piece what you have in sacred music. You have sort of slow harmonic progressions. You have voices echoing each other. You have small little bits of tune that develop into different things. All of that is found, 500-600 years ago, but they've just put a thumping beat on it. But a lot of that music, and I think all music puts us in a special spiritual place. You know, my professors of music would listen to rap, and they would listen to ABBA, and they would listen to Gregorian chant and everything in between, because music should be respected for what it does to us, which is go to those places where words can't find. And I think that is always valuable in our lives, whether the faith bit of it. You know, I would say music is faith. I would say, it's faith without dogma. And it's worship without doctrine. And I think there's something hugely valuable in that.
I think a good indication can always be as well, Callum, about listening to the body. What does the body tell us about its reaction to something that it's hearing or feeling or seeing? And when we have such a strong reaction to a piece of music, that's your body's way of indicating that it's something that, you know, it either likes or it needs in some way.
Yeah, I mean, being a performer, it's even more enhanced because you're physically making that music. So it can be I'm not a scientist, so I don't know if it engages all parts of the brain, but as people saying it definitely does it for me.
I saw it online, it must be true. Definitely read it somewhere. Do you know the thing is, though, for people maybe at Callum as well who've not listened to that, the type of music that we're talking about, you know, the choral music before, or gone somewhere and heard a church choir perform, do you think it can be a chance for people to find that moment? I mean, we spoke there about what Philip was saying. It's almost a sort of form for some people of meditation, that space for reflection, that space for time to say or look at things from a different perspective or look inwardly, the chance that maybe we don't necessarily do if we're rushing about and we get coffee or, you know, the things that we get caught up in. Yeah.
No, I think a classic case is the choral evensong, which I believe congregations are rising for that service, because it is a time to not look at your phone. It's a time to sit in a space, whether it's old or new, to listen to choral music, to listen to poetry, to have the senses stimulated, but to be still. And that is something that more so than ever needs to be highlighted. I think the religious side of things, sadly, people get put off by that. But if they, I would say they could give it a chance and see how that makes them feel to sit quietly in a space and be very kind of passive if they want to be. You can be as involved or as uninvolved in it as well.
I suppose I don't want to mention the C word at this point, Philip, but Christmas is a time that a lot of people can maybe get access to this type of music through carols and you know, music they might be familiar with that might make them feel a certain way and they don't even realise they're doing it.
Yeah, thank you for not mentioning that.
I wonder where you're going with that.
Because it's, as a priest, it's just a mountain heading towards me.
Well, listen, you've got AI to help you now, so you're okay.
Oh, God, don't. but I think actually one thing that kind of mentioned there was sort of actually singing, participating, you know, with a lot of choral music, which is, you know, whether we're singing a hymn or, like I say, where you're singing a chant on a football pitch, your instrument is you. And there's something really intimate about that. You know, you are creating your own voice. And the fact that, you know, if you listen to people talk, you know, the three of us here, or, you know, your parents or somebody from a different country, our voices are all so different. And yet we can create harmony together by using our own instruments of our bodies. You know, that makes music both intimate and, you know, generous to the whole world. I think that's one of the great gifts that music gives us.
Yeah, creating harmony, there's an idea. Listen, lovely to speak to both of you, Callum Robertson and the Reverend Philip Blacklish. Thank you, Philip, for your time earlier in the programme as well. The Old St Paul's Choir's new recording is available now on CD or online for download from their website. But that is all from me this week. And actually, for a wee while, actually, I'll be back with you in the new year. Tony Kearney is back with you next week. We've got the Sunday show coming next, we've got Off the Ball later, and of course Sports Sound for the second semi-final of the Viaplay Cup. To leave you this morning, the one last song, this is a new release from... See you next time. Have a good Sunday. Bye bye.
Put them together, come on. Come on. I was blind, but now I see.
God be praised.
God be praised. To me, all I can say is, the hand of God's all over me.
God be praised.
God be praised.
God be praised.
I walk by faith in victory. God has been so good to me, all I can say is, you know that God.
Yes, he did it.
God has been so good to me, all I can say is,
God, he
clap your hands. Clap your hands. I'm blessed when I'm up and when I'm down.
God be praised.
God be praised.
God be praised.
God be praised.
Didn't he?
God has been so good to me, all I can say is
God be praised.
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 God be praised. Sopranos, God be praised.
God be praised.
God be praised.
God be praised.
Alto, God be praised.
God be praised.
God be praised.
God be praised.
Tell us, God be praised.
God be praised.
God be praised.
God be praised.
Everybody clap your hands.
God be praised.
God be praised.
God be praised.
Praising in the morning. Praising in the noonday. Praising all day long. Or strong.
God
has been so good to me, all I can say is clap your hands. Pastor Eric Thomas.
God be praised. Help me praise him. Come on and open up. Open up your mouth. Let me see you clap those hands. Clap, 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 clap those hands.